First World Order Radio, finally, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. Alright, alright.
There's always gonna be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value and natural characteristics. Radio. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
You have activated Pisces Man, which have produced this black chemical called melanin.
What we did was...
Peace. Welcome once again to First World Order Radio. Dr. Aline Bay is your host, and we have our co-hosts coming on. We have Brother Olabala, as well as also Grand Sheik Fahim El.
How
y'all doing tonight?
Well, very well, brothers. How y'all brothers doing tonight?
Great,
doing well,
great.
All
back
right.
Again.
Very well. Very well.
Back again.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to go into the return of the ancient ones tonight. Washington, the return of the ancient ones. And what does that really mean? And why should it matter to you as the listeners? Well, we're going to get right into it.
Yeah. Good question.
That back in May 16, 2004, my wife and I and some other delegates of United Washington got a chance to meet the Empress, and she was very alert, very talkative, and outside of wanting to know our names, you know, the major concern she had was, have y'all read my book in reference to Return of the Ancient Ones? And of course, we said, yes, ma'am, we have read it. She looked at each and every one of us and said, good, that is what you all need. You know, in other words, that is what we will need, you know, in order to continue this progress here of getting our people awoken to who they actually are. You know, so we give high honors to Brother Joe Frederick Washington, the Empress's son in the Royal Region of the Empire of Washington, Deduct Demonia. All right. Now, if you go to her book, The Return of the Ancient Ones, she says this book, The Return of the Ancient Ones, must be read by everyone, especially in the world of the academia, for it is surely foundations of the ivory-covered walls for sure. Some may anger, and others it would definitely more than please. The Empress has survived, as the history-shaking contents of this profound, powerful book will attest to. and far as all of those details you may, that you might just weigh, well, that's another book. So, basically, this book here is so powerful. And for those who don't have to return to the ancient ones written by the Empress, Wadiyasi, L.A., we suggest that you definitely get your hands on this book. We have copies of it. For those that's interested, you can contact us at 910-364-9099. That's 910-364-9099. And you definitely have to get your hands on it because, huh?
You will hear from me about that book.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So, for those out there, I'm listening. Definitely check us out. Because once you read it, there's no turning back. There ain't no turning back once you get your hands on this book. Because the vast estate in which that was mentioned by Prophet Obadiah Lee of the Moorish Science Temple of America, of the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, of the world, of the Moorish Divine National Movement. What we can say is that he was part of this family bloodline, and the vast estate had to be connected to the family because based on what they told us in history, he went to Havana, Cuba in 1928. And as he was there, he received a mandate, a land mandate, matter of fact. All right. Now, what we do know is that that land mandate, and what they are talking about, we have a clue on what mandates that they're talking about. For example, Brother I. Cook Bay, who was Grand Governor of Illinois, said that the Holy Prophet Obadiah Lee told the Moors that the Europeans went to the Moroccan government and asked for permission to come over here to develop this land, and they was given a 50-year mandate to do so. Then the Europeans went to an old sheik and asked him to give them some people to help them to develop this land. Now, that ain't got nothing to do with slavery or indentured servitude.
Right.
Right? But this is what it turned into. The sheik told them to take those Moors because they was not going to do anything. Now, this is what it was referenced. Now, check this out, though. But this is a direct reference, actually, to the Treaty of Peace and Friendship between Morocco and the United States, which every 50 years is supposed to be signed by the Moroccan government, or in particular, the prince or the king of Morocco. Okay? As a matter of fact, I think it was like around 1983 or sometime around in the 80s when the prince actually refused to sign the Moroccan treaty, and he ended up getting killed supposedly by accident in a boat accident. Okay. Now, when you study the Moroccan Treaty, you know that it was written in 1787. Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin worked closely with the Moors and the Continental Congress to secure this treaty. That's where the treaty came from. All right. That's who they was talking about, the Moroccan, the Emperor of Morocco. It was not Morocco over there. All right. Which is the Kingdom of Morocco. We're talking about the Empire al-Morocco, which is here. All right. So in the Beauvais collection, there were 200 letters to the Bey of Morocco from the Continental Congress. There was many Moors in the Continental Congress working with the European Masons, the Muslim Sons, originally taught by the Moors, to form a Novus Ordo Seclorum, which is a new world order. All right. The Moroccan treaty is very powerful because according to the Constitution, treaties are the law of the land. Now, you know that's in Article 6 of the Constitution. It says this Constitution, its laws, and the treaties are the law of land. So this treaty specifically dealt with Moors. The question then may arise, how do we know that where the treaty say Moors? It says that so-called black people of that time are being referred to. Well, when you read the treaty, word more is mentioned many times throughout the treaty. All right, so that's proof within itself right there. But, you know, if you get J. Rogers' Sex and Race book, or Missing Pages of History by Indo-Kim and Kush, or what they never told you in history class, they tell you specifically, okay, about the Moors, and that the original Moors were, i.e., so-called black. All right? It tells you that. Matter of fact, it says the Moors was black, just like the Egyptians. If you get Chancellor Williams' book, Destruction of Black Civilization. So, January the 20th through 1928 through February the 16th, 1928, Prophet Noble Dry Leaf went to the 6th Annual Pan-American Conference held in Havana, Cuba. This is the 6th Annual American Conference of 1928 on missing, but it would fit brothers and sisters to go to the Library of Congress, and they have not come back with it as of yet. So this cannot be verified as truth of not. However, it's been said enough about the Moors that it had to lead some type of credence to it, because the Secretary of State Hughes went down to represent the United States, and Prophet Noble Dry Leaf went down to represent the Moors as head of the nation state. At the conference, the mandate for the landmass of Greater Mexico, which is North, Central, and South America, all right, was returned to the Moors. Now, Prophet Noble Dry Leaf knew what this meant and what the ramifications of this was, and then you get this from Exhuming of a Nation, the biography of Prophet Noble Dry Leaf by Lesson Bay. Right. Now, there's another excerpt, another book called The Montauk Book of the Dead by Peter Moon. In the Ali Shuffle, it states, in 1928, Ali attended a Pan-American conference in Havana, Cuba, where he enjoyed broad recognition from a host of other countries. They were, of course, recognizing the sovereign status, right, because Noble Dry Leaf actually was a prince of the Washita Ternaca and the fifth royal regent of the Marquise de Maison Rouge, which was representing the ancient empire of Mexico, which is Al Morocco. Now, the document Dry Leaf received was a copy of a mandate whereby the Mexican Moroccan Empire extended a land grant to the entire Western Hemisphere to certain Europeans. Essentially, at least American to a certain party, which that certain party actually was William Penn, as they put together from out of the company, all that is connected, for a particular number of years, not unlike the way that China leased Hong Kong to Great Britain. The lease was up in 2004.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's when the lease was up. In 2004. Now, that's nearly 10 years ago, yo.
It was.
All right. Now, if you get, according to my man, Abdullah El Talib Mosey Bey, he says that the United States of America Corporation is the administrative authority of our Moorish territories, which are in the category of trust territories under mandate of the United Nations. The United Nations would terminate the United States of America's mandate over Moorish territories, and the Great Seal Federal Republic government once again will regain a full measure of self-government sovereign capacity. The United Nations International Declaration of the World Indigenous Peoples, which from 1995 through 2004, is the window period that the United Nations have set to terminate out all mandates of territory currently administered as trust territories, thereby eliminating colonialism and enslavement of the world's indigenous peoples. This is why, by 2007, you get a passing of the Declaration of the Rights of the People. And by 2010, December 16, 2010, Barack Obama signs on to the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People. So by international law and national law, the United States of America Corporation is obliged to honor and respect the Treaty of Peace and Friendship of 1787. Article 6 of the Constitution of the United States, like I said, makes that the Treaty of Peace and Friendship, as well as other treaties, the supreme law of the land that governs all matters of intercommerce, laws between Moors and the foreign Christians. All right? Now, you got to understand, that was the, when you go and read New Atlantis by Francis Bacon, i.e., known as William Shakespeare, the one who founded the modern-day Masonic Order, as well as also who was one of the heads of the Rosicrucians, who was also a Moor, for those who did not know. You can actually get pictures of William Shakespeare's funeral, all right? His funeral head and torso, and his brown skin, dark skin, all right? This is why he wrote about Othello, you know, the Moors, the Venice, you know. This is why he wrote so much about the Moors and so forth and so on in his plays, because he himself is a Moor. Now, so if you go and read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was December 10th, 1948, the Covenant of the Rights of Indigenous Nations, July 28th, 1994, you get the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, passed September 7th. And adopted September 13, 2007. Now, that was a strange time, and I'm going to show you the coincidence between that. You had Tupac Amaru Shakur. Tupac was named after an Inca, all right, king, Amaru. The word Amaru is where we get the word Amaru Ka, all right? In which that is an ancient name, in which that the indigenous people refer to this land as Amaru Ka. All right, this name did not come from Americo Vespucci, Alberto. His name was not Americo. So that was another lie in history reconstruction, in which that they did in order to throw us off as if the European is the one who founded everything.
Yeah.
But when in history has they ever used a European first name as founding of anything? They always use, like for the word Lafayette, they always use the last name. You have Fayetteville, or you have Washington, George Washington. You have Washington as in Washington State, as in Washington, D.C. They always use the last name. But amazingly, if you remember, September the 7th through September the 13th was the time when Tupac got killed, or supposedly died. Got shot and died. He got shot September the 7th, right? Of 1996?
Somewhere, I think.
I think it was around that
97, I can't remember.
No, Biggie got killed March 97. So Tupac got killed supposedly September the 7th. He got shot and then died September the 13th.
Okay.
Now, I don't think that was coincidence that United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People was passed during that same time period when Tupac was shot and when he died, allegedly, because many said he's still living. All right? And that he's in Haiti or somewhere, you know, or in Cuba, you know, and allegedly, you know, Jay-Z and them went down to Cuba, and this is how they got his aunt put on the most wanted list by the FBI and so forth and so on. You know, who knows? But all of that is connected, you know what I'm saying? But I don't think it's no coincidence that that was passed on that same time sequence. Then you have the Inter-American Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People. of 1995, you have the Charter 11 Declaration regarding non-self-government governing territories. Chapter 11, International Trusteeship System. And Chapter 13, the Trusteeship Council. Now, these are the international laws that we need to be looking into, because these things will tell us what is actually taking place. All right? And this goes back to what Sister M. Howell L. of Temple 19 said, that Prophet Nobodrali told them. He said, I brought you your nationality, your religion, and your nobility title, or your title to your vast estate. Okay? Now, the proof of the vast estate comes from chapter 47 in the Moorish Holy Quran, Circle 7, and also based on the charter of warrant and disposition. All right? I know that you used the name El Baydey Al Ali. These were the names used during the last days under the Ottoman Empire. All right? Which is the Maxim Empire or Marokka. Right? Now, Prophet Nobodrali took several stopgap measures to secure the Moorish birthright, inheritance, and beneficiary interest of Moors to the last wherein the aforementioned land mandate, in which was part and parcel of the vast estate, express trust. All right. It is alleged that Prophet Drew Ali said that I have got the world in a jug and the stopper in my hand. Mm. Others say that Prophet Drew Ali said that I have got the world in a jug, you know what I'm saying? And I've got the and I got the my hand, but he goes further and say, I've got the Asiatics and I got the Europeans. I've got the gold. No, I got the silver and I've got the gold. Okay, now we got to go back and analyze what he means by that, because there's a lot of stuff that isn't being told, and nor do I think that the various temple structures understand fully what is taking place.
Right.
You know, now we know that the Secretary of State, Hughes, who was there on behalf of the United States government, was made privy to the land mandate. So were several other heads, you know what I'm saying, of state. 2 months after Nobodrali made transition, which was July 20th, 1929, which was a year right after, directly a year after him coming to form the Moorish Science Temple of America. Now, the board trustees over the wealth of the Moorish nation, which is Wall Street, realized it was too late, and the stock market crashed, and the United States was forced to declare bankruptcy. The so-called United States, Great Britain, France, Germany, Italy, Spain, and Portugal convened in Geneva, Switzerland for 5 continuous years, from 1928 to 1932, to set up what would be the policy of all of the participating countries. All right, now, this everybody began to become de facto is based off of this, based off of what just happened.
Mm-hmm.
So these 5 years of meeting became known as Geneva Convention. In 1930, the so-called United States, Great Britain, France, Germany, Italy, Spain, and Portugal all declared bankruptcy. Any attempts to obtain the minutes of the 1930 Geneva Convention are futile, because they published the volumes of minutes for every year of the Geneva Convention, including 1930, but refused to make the 1930 minutes available to the public because they contained the evidence of the bankruptcy. Okay. Now, going into 1932, the state stopped meeting in Geneva. And in 1932, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt became United States president, and his job was to put in place and administer the bankruptcy that the United States has declared 2 years earlier, and hide the bankruptcy from the public by establishing a reorganized plan called DIL, or the administrative state that functions under the color of law of the United States of America. Once again, America is not of the United States. United States is a corporation of America, and we are the Americans, so therefore we have a superior position.
Yeah.
The United States of America and the United States of America, along with the United States Constitution, became default from the moment on, and all that remained was the bankruptcy by the profit corporations known as the United States. Now, for those who don't want to believe that, you can go to Title 26 of the Code of the Federal Regulations, Section 1.911-2. Okay. Now, Britain has a democratic military venue under martial law, which is War Power Act, and the Uniform Commercial Code, which is Hebrew Commercial Law. The so-called states are revamped their local constitutions by 1938. And remember, you can still use all these instruments, the state constitutions. You can use this because they never told you about the fraud.
Mm-hmm.
All right? They never told you that they turned you into corporate citizens. Now, you take into account their capitalization of this matter and to bankrupt mother corporations during businesses as the United States. That's how they was doing business as the United States. This cleared the way for the Buck Act of 1940, allowing a corporate United States to extend its jurisdiction and by default absurd all sovereignty over the now defunct state republics. Right? Now, getting back to Roosevelt, he was sworn into the United States presidency January 1933, and wasted no time in getting started with the bankruptcy. The bankruptcy is expressed in Franklin Roosevelt's executive order number 6073. And 6111 and 6260. Now you go and check the United States Senate reports 93-549, page 187 and 594. Under the Trading with the Enemy Act, in which they turn you into the traitors. They turn you into the enemies of 1917, codified as the United States Code, Title 12, Section 95A, and House Joint Resolution 192 of June 5th, 1933, confirmed in Perry versus United States, 1933. And his case cites 294 United States 330-381 and United States Code, Title 31, Section 5112 and 5119. It says that Roosevelt immediately shut the banks down, called a banking holiday, and proceeded to pull all the gold out of circulation while replacing it with a debt currency tender IOU. And the United States is tributary to the Moors, and they have to repay $25 million in a gold loan that was made to the United States government in 1861. Right? This is what people don't know. They owe us. So when we talk about reparations, right, so we can't get for reparations if we're not coming back as Moors, because this is who they paid the tributary to. This is where they get the term blackmail from, as if we was extorting from them. Now, you can get that from Ancient and Modern Britain, Volume 1 and 2 by David McRitchie. The United States Congress is responsible to repay, which is why the seal of the Moors, which is the all-seeing eye and the pyramid, is on the back of the dollar bill. Now you see why they have to come out with the conspiracy theories and say, wow, that's the Illuminati symbol. That's the Illuminati symbol. So that the dummies who don't look into the Moorish information would never get to reparation, because it's only come by way of being recognized as a Moor and utilizing the Treaty of Peace and Friendship of Morocco, as well as also the Treaty of Camp Holmes and other treaties. The Treaty of the Barbary Treaties, the Treaty of Tripoli, several treaties that we will have to utilize, because they owe us. The European nations paid tribute to the Moors well into the 19th century. And you can get this from David McRitchie's book on United States and Barbary Powers. The United States, England, France, Dutch, Danes, and Swedes. all paid tribute to the Moors. All of them. Okay, this is why the United States Marines sang of the defeating of the Moors from the halls of Montezuma, which is in Mexico, to the shores of Tripoli, which is in Libya.
Exactly.
Confirming the song in the song the extent of the Moorish Empire and the dominion of a Maxim or Atlantis. But the United States is not a nation nor a nationality.
Mm-hmm.
American is the nationality. United States is a citizen, which is a subject. Nevertheless, once again, American is a nationality. Read your divine warning by the prophet for the nations, by Prophet Noble Dry Lee. I need all support from all true American citizens of the United States of America. Help me to save my people who have fallen from the constitutional laws of the government. Once again, what's the supreme laws of the Constitution? Its laws, the Constitution, and the treaties. So long as you're not utilizing the treaty, you're falling from the constitutional law. Look, this is the United States Supreme Court case that they've been trying to hide. This is United States of 1995. It says, in as much as every government is an artificial person, an abstraction and a creature of the mind only, a government can interface only with other artificial persons. Oh, shit. Once again. Let's say that again. A government can only interface with other artificial persons. Oh, shit. One more time. Now you know why we've been talking about for the last 2 weeks, how they turned you into an artificial person, a dummy, straw man, strawmanius homo. It says the imaginary having neither actuality nor substance. A government don't have an actuality nor substance. It's foreclosed from creating and obtaining parity with the tangible. The legal manifestation of this is no government, as well as any law, agency, aspect, court, etc., can consider itself with anything other than corporation, artificial person, and the contracts between them. Now, if you don't believe me, go and get from 1795 Penhallow versus Doan Administrators, 3 United States 54, 1L edition 57, 3 Dallas 54. So they can't do anything unless they turn into an artificial person, and that's what they say of the birth certificate. As we told you, you are right. It goes further on and says that there is a clear distinction in this particular case between an individual and a corporation, and that the latter has no right to refuse to submit its books and papers for examination at the suit of the state. The individual may stand upon his constitutional rights as a citizen. He is entitled to carry on his private business in his own way. His power to contract is unlimited. He owes no such duty to the state, since he received nothing therefrom beyond the protection of his life and property. His rights are such or exist by the laws of the land, long to the organization of the state, and can only be taken from him by due process of law and in accordance with the Constitution. Amongst his rights are a refusal to incriminate himself and the immunity of himself and his property from arrest or seizure without a warrant of law. He owes nothing to the public so long as he does not trespass upon their rights. Under the other hand, the corporation is a creature of the state. It is presumed to be incorporated for the benefit of the public. It receives certain special privileges and franchises and holds them subject to the laws of the state and to the limitation of its charter. His power are limited by law. It can make no contracts not authorized by its charter. It rights to act as a corporation are only preserved to it so long as it obeys the laws of its charter. Now, this is Hell versus Tinkle. Right now, we're telling you that they have you classified as an artificial person. This is that's the only way that they're able to do business with you, and this is verified in the two cases that we just read.
Mm-hmm.
Now, your lawyers don't tell you none of this information. Wonder why?
They're not going to admit the bankruptcy.
Exactly. And so that's what they work for. So the judge is actually a banker or administrator. Bankruptcy. He's the administrator of the bankruptcy. And he's using you as the collateral based on the original contract, which is the birth certificate. All right. Now, if you go to definition of the United States, it says United States means a federal corporation, an agency, department, commission, board, or other entity of the United States, an instrumentality of the United States. Now, check that out now. The United States, the word government is not even in the definition of the word United States. You also have the United States of America Incorporated, which if you go to www.de.us, which is Delaware, it says that nonprofit Delaware Corporation. So the United States of America Incorporated is another fraud or fiction in which they have created. All right? And it says nonprofit Delaware Corporation Incorporated date, check this out, 4/19/89. File number 2193946. It says a religious, check this out, the entity type is a religious nonprofit. So the United States of America Incorporated is a religious nonprofit. Wonder why they started talking so much about Christianity after Reagan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because they started talking about it was a religious nonprofit. That's what they turned United States of America Incorporated. That's what it is. Now, go to Count Voynich's book. He authored the book, The Ruins of Empires. Now, there's a translator, Joel Barlow. I think he lived from 1750 to 1812. He himself was an American, well known for drafting the Islam appeasing Treaty of Tripoli, in which it was written that the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion. Now, this is in the Treaty of Tripoli, the 8th section 154. So what are they doing talking about Christianity? When the founders say it was not in any sense founded on the Christian religion. Because it was founded on Islam.
Exactly, yes. Mm-hmm.
The United States is a religious corporation now managed by Queen Elizabeth and under the control of the Vatican. The Pope's laws are obligated to everyone. Now, if you read this in the Benedict 15, syllabus, property 28, 29, 44. So, therefore, all Moors, i.e. blacks, Negroes, and coloreds, contacting with the United States or chattel property of the Vatican. Go to www.manta.com. Go to that website. It's owned by Dun & Bradstreet. If you research the private corporations under the United States government, you will find the onus is listed as being Archbishop Derek J. McCloy of the Basilica of the National Shrine of the Immaculate Conception of Washington, D.C. That's who owns the United States government.
Wow.
The de facto government.
That's who owned the British
corporation. Now, since Archbishops of the Vatican was, right, now, since Archbishops of the Vatican are sworn to poverty, then the Archbishop can only be named agent for the secular so-called Roman government or Roman Empire, situated in the so-called city or state called the Vatican or Papal State. Now, according to the element of Ecclesiastical Law 20, it says the Pope can abolish any law in the United States. Why? Because it is a religious corporation. It's a Christian society now. Because they no longer follow Islamic principles. Everybody getting this?
Oh, yeah. I am.
So check this out. Because this is amazing to me. Recently, we got word that the Pope, being that he has the ability to abolish any law in the United States, he abolished the law in which that dealt with the immunities of judges and court officials.
Wow.
In other words, we can sue their asses now.
At will.
All right? So, this is why when you read Oral Statements and Prophecies of Prophet Noble Ali, Booker T, or T. Booker Bay, he stated that the prophet stated, I have got the Romans in the palm of my hand. Prophet Obadrali also said, don't throw away your Bibles because I'm going to use them to condemn the government.
Yes, okay. Even the judges, by him not giving the judges no longer immunity, that means we as nationalized aboriginal indigenous Moors, we can sue judges at will now.
Exactly.
They really have to watch their back. Because we are coming.
And that was just done by Pope Francis within the last 3 weeks. Just done.
See, but the Moors that talk about trying to enforce the nationality card, see, they have to learn how to understand. They cannot do business with us as a sovereign. They can't do it because the way things are set up. That's why a lot of us get state IDs or whatever, you know, to do certain business or to transact certain business. Other than that, they can't do business with us.
That's right.
Is the when I went to the Social Security Administration, to let them know that I had got my name corrected, and I gave them my nationality card, and they took it back to the office, and they came back with it and said, well, there's nothing we can do with this. Do you have a state ID? And I said, yes, I gave a state ID. They said, oh, okay, that's wonderful, you know.
Right, yeah, because they can't do business, exactly.
So they can't do anything with a nationality card, you know. So,
right.
Because they could, if they did, that means they have to admit the bankruptcy. And they're not going to do, they're not going to admit that.
Right about that.
What do you got to say about that, Lola Bala? Lola Bala, L, you there?
Is Lola Bala on here?
Yeah, he was here.
Uh-oh. Oh, hold on. Let me see if he got cut off or something. I don't see him.
Oh.
All right, so we continue on. As a matter of fact, we're going to go to the commercial right quick and come right back and get back into it.
All right.
First of all, on the radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. You get on into some of that information. First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m. We got to talk about what is taking place. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information online. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. Now we're going to make this the hottest beat.
Proceeding lovers in time, order, and importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Every state of human conservation in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates the brain about specific things that do based on value with natural hair with domestic. Current radiates electromagnetistic of sound through the thing that your thoughts. Proceeding lovers in time, order, and importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. State of human concerns in existence, and it definitely must have two quantity or distance. System regulates the brain of a specific thing to do based on value or natural chemicals. 188 electromagnetistics of sound through the thing that your thoughts transmit.
You need to understand
that's
magical. This is something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know how intention is straight out. All right. So, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of the ancient mystery school back again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, bringing y'all some surefire dynamite, we're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophy, theories, shit that works.
You have activated pilot man who have produced this black chemical called melanin.
What we did was gave a hard line in the sand between different definitions of esoteric studies and exoteric studies. Playtime is over.
No doubt, playtime is over.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let's get back to this topic here. We know we're dealing with a fiction in which that can only deal with another fiction.
Yeah.
That's the reason why your name was put in all caps. And by stating that, that's the reason why they will be admitting to the bankruptcy, as Brother L said. Okay. Now, Prophet Noble Jali said also within the oral statements and prophecies that the Moors are the offsprings of kings and queens. Now, who they're talking about? They're talking about the Omeks or the Al-Malik, which means the kings. The Al-Malika, the queens. the rulers of Omexum, where you get the word Omex from, which is talking about the north, central, and south, and the adjoining islands. We've given out so much information over the last 2 years. It would behoove you to research what we're talking about. But these are the missing pieces in which that these so-called Afrocentristic teachers are not telling you. Jesse Jackson is not telling you. Al Sharpton is not telling you.
Uh-huh.
They're doing it purposely in order to keep making money off of the demise of the Moors. In other words, they've joined in with the so-called white Masonic Shriners that their job is to hold the Moors down. But this is now the renaissance of the Moors. This is the Moorish renaissance. And the Moors are on the rise once again. And Prophet Nobodrali said that the Moors will come into their own in 2000. Talking about as in 2000 AD. And that is exactly what is happening. That is exactly what is happening.
Mm-hmm.
You got to say about that, Brother L?
I said exactly. Yes, like I said before, we're definitely coming, you know, so a lot of these judges, they better watch out, you know, especially their cannon fodder police officers. That cannon fodder is a term, in the military term, they usually use lower-ranking soldiers as cannon fodder, the face to fire. While the more high-ranking officers stand behind the lines and give orders. And that's what police officers are. They have cannon fodders. So but when the Pope had, when you just said the Pope had had threw him out to, you know, leave him out to hang to dry, that's what he done. So, you know, as far as people that really know law, that really know the law, well, all I can say is watch out for the people that out here doing dirt. I mean, I'm not saying this. Watch out for the people, like the judges, and a lot of these law enforcement or so-called law enforcement officers really are nothing but revenue agents. That's what I'm talking about. Watch out.
Okay.
Wars is on the rise, and we are coming. You know. I mean, they're not just coming just to be coming for them, but you come out here to do us harm and to do us dirt to us, then, yeah, we are coming for you. Because as Dr. Eileen L. Fay just said, you know, hey, it's our time. Not the time for the black man to rise or the black woman to rise, the time for the Asiatic Moor men and women to rise. As Moors, not black people, not Negroes, not African Americans, not Negroes.
Right, and if people don't understand the difference, go to the slave laws in Virginia. This is in 1682, the Slave Code received additions. It was enacted that runaways who refused to be arrested might be lawfully killed. Slaves were forbidden to carry arms, offenses, or defenses, or to go off the plantation of their masters without a written pass, or to lift a hand against a Christian, even in self-defense. The conditions of slavery were imposed upon all servants. Check this out now. Whether Negroes, Moors, Mulattoes, or Indians brought into the colony by sea or land, whether converted to Christianity or not, provided that they were not a Christian parentage or country, or if Turk or Moors in amnesty with His Majesty. That was specifically what the mandate was for. Mandate. All right? Mm-hmm. That's the Treaty of piece of furniture from Morocco. And some of the Moors who was in amnesty with His Majesty. But it says, check this out. It says the condition of slavery was imposed now upon all servants, whether Negroes, Moors, Mulattoes, or Indians. So you got to understand, that was all the same to them. You was a nigger. All right, unless you had amnesty with His Majesty. Now that is in Popular Encyclopedia of the United States History, Volume 2, published 1893, page 1299. Now go to South Carolina law. Check this out. Check out what they say here. The term Negro is confined to slave Africans, the ancient Berbers, and their descendants. It does not embrace the free inhabitants of Africa, such as the Egyptians, Moors, or the Asiatics, such as the Lakars. And this is from South Carolina Agricultural Society, published 1848. Now I'm making a difference here. Because when you go, and we spoke about this before, you go and watch the movie Roots, Alex Haley, 1977, there was a scene where Kunta Kinte, Toby, escaped and was on the run. Two overseers were after him. The overseers or officers came in contact with two free blacks, all right, Moors, a father and son, on a horse and buggy, a carriage. The overseer stopped him and asked him to see his papers. The father put out his papers and showed them, and they took them and cast them back at him and continued on after Kunta Kinte, Toby. Now, the movie, Alex Haley, never goes into the detail what was these, you know, these papers. Obviously, they was his freedom papers. In fact, if you go, matter of fact, the word freedom paper, or rather writs to say born free, was spoken of again in the movie Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter, by character Will Johnson, played by Anthony Mackie. He said it in there that Abe, look, I need for you to write me some. I need for you to write me a writ for my freedom. Even though he was born free, he needed documentation to prove that he was born free.
Right.
So you definitely got to check out that information, because that's what's going on. Even today, we're finding those same situations. Racial profiling hasn't changed.
No.
You get the book The New Jim Crow, written by Michelle Alexander. She tells you that the new plantation is the prison system.
Exactly.
And that they putting us in the prison systems, doing these types of things to us, in which that equals cattle property or chattel property. All right. Let me go to another article right quick. This is actually written by the Empress from Inner City Plow. It says, continuing her quest to bring light to truth, the Empress Vidyasi Tierra Washitor Turnica Gastonel Bay calling 40 years of work, including research as an archivist, in order to locate documents and treaties concerning lands known as the Louisiana Purchase, in which her people are identified as the ancient ones. The Empress said this land was never included in any land deal, that it was not part of the Louisiana Purchase when sold by Spain to France, nor was it part of it when it bought in 1803 when France rolled it over to the United States of America. She writes, President Thomas Jefferson was well aware of this fraud of this fraudulent land deal and stated his sentiments at the time. In truth, the land spoken of never been part of the United States of America. It always belonged to the ancient ones. This sounds like the same President Abraham Lincoln was going to the Moors after slavery. He called it Egypt of the West, or Central America, the land between the Rocky and the Allegheny. Mountains from the Gulf of Mexico up into Canada and on both sides of the Mississippi. In 1848, the Washita or Oshita, the Tonica nations turned their land case, took their land case before the United States Supreme Court and won their case under Judge Ken, the same judge who in 1856 gave his opinion, which was not a legal decision in the tragic Dred Scott case, which basically stated there is nothing a black man has that a white man is bound to respect. The judge's opinion meant further slavery and the death to Washita, Tonica, and nations. Okay. It says they was murdered by the tens of thousands, enslaved, and ran off their land. Their names were changed to hide the history, to hide the truth of their history. The Washita became Washington, and the Tonica became Turner. Okay.
Hmm.
Now, that right there, you got it making. And these particular cases, what you need to get is the United States versus the heirs of Henry Turner. Case 32, United States Appellate Court. Also in 1850 was an appeal to an earlier court case by the heirs of Henry Turner. The heirs of Henry Turner versus the United States case 191 in 1848. So in other words, on June 6, 1848, a Supreme Court decision ruled by Theo H. McCollum, judge declared that the United States does not own the land of the ancient ones, Mao Buddhas of North America, more than 1 million acres, square miles of land. All right. Excuse me, 1 million square miles of land. Moors are the title holders. The titles are El Bey de Al Ali, translated as the five civilized so-called Indian tribes of Choctaw, which is Washita, Cherokee, Chickasaw, Creek, which is Muscogee, and Seminole, which is Yamasee. Says also the court declared lawful land owners are the heirs of Henry Turner. In a series of congressional bills or acts, and the United States Supreme Court affirms national sovereignty for the heirs of Henry Turner of the Bourbon, and the claim has been recorded before the World Court at The Hague back in 1994. And since the treaties of Utrecht, 1713, in which that the Spanish de Bourbon was established themselves as the protectorate of land known as the Floridas on behalf of the Empire de Dagdemania. Here are two United States Supreme Court cases in which the Washita won. You can go to supreme.justia.com/US/53/663/. And supreme.justia.com/US/44/773/case/AHTML. All right. So it was over 1 million acres of land, in which that, matter of fact, it goes as high as 30 million when you add in the fact of almost the whole of Canada. All right? So the United States has recognized Empire Washita de Dagdemania as an indigenous people of North America and has under consideration in the 105 Congress, House Resolution number 260, and the Guadalupe Hidalgo Treaty Land Claim Act of January 1997. Right? There's documentation in the National Archives of Washington, D.C. that also confirms the Washita as the ancient mound buildings.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm giving you all this information because we tied up the nonsense taking place
right.
In the so-called conscious community. It's real simple. Go and do your research.
That's all you got to do. Ain't nothing to it but to get up and do it. No, just go do your research. That will support everything you are saying tonight, Grand Sheik.
Right. Definitely.
Some of the things I said. Just go to just check it out. Go to libraries or go to the bookstore and just look for some of the books that Dr. Eileen told you to go get and buy. Study them. Don't just read them and half read them, whatever, and just put it down to some place in your home and let it collect dust. Read them and study the books. Find out things a lot better for you and for your families and everything else. And then you get out there, then you can do something, then you can fix some things for yourself and for your family and for our people. So we can come back and then link ourselves with the family of nations like we're supposed to.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of that, I mean, isn't that what Prophet Noble Jali said? Bring us back into the constitutional fold? Link us back with the nations?
Yeah. Yeah. Do that by, if you can, acquiring gold, silver, copper, what's coming soon, Emerald dollars, for what I've heard from Dr. Eileen, that the only thing that's holding that up is the Mexican peso,
Right.
But I don't see that holding up for too long, considering how Mexico,
right.
The way Mexico is going now, So just a matter of time. Some of us, when it is our time, some of us need to learn to speak different languages, foreign languages, because we need interpreters to communicate with other people all over the world. If you want to take up Chinese, okay, fine. We need that so we can communicate. You want to take up European language, French, okay. We need that too. But I say, first of all, try to learn as much as our own tribal nation, our national names first, our languages first, as much as we can.
Right, and for those who don't know what Brother Elder is talking about, he's talking about the Metuneta, he's talking about Hebrew, he's talking about Arabic. These languages known as Hamitic and Semitic languages. These are languages on which that was found here in the Americas. When, according to Christopher Columbus and his son, when they came to the West Indies, in particular Cuba, they seen a mosque on top of the hill already built. And a tall black emperor or met him at the shores on which that this emperor spoke Chaldean, Hebrew, and Arabic.
There's the proof. There's the proof right there. Like the saying goes, the proof is in the pudding.
That's good. Hold on, Brother L. We're going to go to commercial and come right back.
All right.
First of all, on the radio, finally, we are on there. No doubt.
right away. There's always going to be somebody on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday, 8 o'clock, is now the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding in levels in time, order, and instruments. The state of human concerns and existence. And the human quantity or distance. System regulates the brain about specific things that we in time, order, importance. The most prominent instruments. Of human concerns and existence. And it definitely must have two quantity or distance. System regulates the brain about specific things that do based on value and natural
Journal Truth Farm School. And this is what she said. The Washita were and still is a nation of Africans who existed in the southern United States and Mississippi Valley region long before the 16th century Europeans arrived. And even before there was Native Americans, the so-called red men on the lands of Washita once occupied and still occupy today. All right. Indigenous people have been all over the world and specifically on the North American continent for hundreds and thousands of years.
Mm.
Right? She says, actually, there was some Washita here even before African arrived.
Check that out.
When all the continents of the world was one. Right? Dated to when all the worlds were one. This is what it says. All right. She said their lands, the land of all the earth, were known by the indigenous term Mu. Now we know that based on Brother T. Booker Bay, Grand National Treasury, said that Prophet Noble that the Moors was living up and down the Mississippi River before the European man came here. Okay? Was living all up and down the Mississippi before the Europeans came. So just before 400 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right, we got fine. But many get this confused. All right. That's why we gave you the definition Friday on American, as we've been doing several times, so that y'all can put the pieces of this puzzle together.
Exactly.
All right, so. Let's go to another. How. Let's look at how to understand the real signs of your nationality and you reclaiming your nationality. Because many say that you can do nationality just by simply saying it and you don't have to put no paperwork on the public record.
Right.
These are jackasses. There's
a lot of that going on. Sad to say.
Right. Because you got a birth certificate at the damn register of deeds on record, on the public record, in which that is sold on the stock market. And you don't have nothing to counteract that and think just by saying, I'm a Moor, that takes care of it. You a jackass. And stop telling the people them damn lies. The truth of the matter is that you have to have something to counteract what has been put on the record.
Right.
You need a negative avertment or declaration of denial of corporate status. You need an affidavit of nationality, affidavit of citizenship. You need something to counteract what they put on record. You need a baptismal record or a live claim birth form. Stating who you are for the record. Since their record, as I showed you from the information that I read, is a fiction. It's a fiction.
That's right.
And so you gonna say that you are more and allow for the fiction to continue to exist? Or have nothing in place to make it null and void or to counteract it?
They think that's all it takes.
Oh, boy.
Just stand up in the temple and
right.
Go down there and meet the grand sheik, shake his hand, and you are more, just like that. They give you a little card.
Right.
And that's it. No paperwork. No, freedom papers. Nothing. No going down. No getting no papers notarized. No getting no papers, or going to the county records and deeds and get it put on the public record. No going to the circuit county courts, county clerk offices and getting the names corrected. None of that.
So what do you think about that, Brother Ellis, if you went through that process?
When I went through the process, as it was the most experiencing process that I went through, because at that time, it was the first time I'd done that, and I had some few problems going along the way. So I guess you remember when I kept calling you back about certain things I needed to know, whether I did wrong or not. But now I know. Now I don't know how it's being done, and I can help others as they go through the process.
Right, and that was the whole point of you going through it, so that you can learn how to do it, so you can help others in your territory.
Yes. Exactly.
That's the whole science. Because without you going through your trials and errors and learning the procedure, learning the science, you would not have the capability of being able now to be the grand sheik and being able to help others as they come into knowledge of self. And you, your whole job as grand sheik is to uplift fallen humanity.
Yes, exactly.
So how are you going to uplift someone if you didn't go through the process yourself and don't know how it works?
Right. Right.
So that was the science. I had to go through it. I had to learn. I had to go through it myself. But it's not hard.
No.
Once you get the hang of it, it's quite easy, and it's easy to teach others how to do the same thing.
Right.
Because this is about nationality, your birthright. Your status.
Exactly.
That's what
Yes. Just like
now, how you felt about being part of the temple? Why? You know, being that you come out the temple, and the only thing they did was just give you a national ID card and say you was a Moor, and they never told you about the fraud in which that the United States perpetrated. It seemed, if I tell about the fraud, that obviously to me means that you must be part of it.
Exactly. Yes.
What is your thoughts about that?
There is no doubt in my mind that the temple has been compromised. When I first went to the temple, joined the temples, I was pretty excited. You know, I said, "Yeah, now I'm going to be nationalized and everything," and get that. And I was used to, the term I used to say was get my name changed, but they never really say corrected. So I learned from listening to you and other Moorish Grand Sheiks that the name was corrected, not changed. So I had to learn that from DVDs that I listened to.
Right.
And a lot of times I would make statements that they didn't want to hear, which I could not understand. I tried to give them the meaning and the understanding of the fez that they wore on their heads, which I learned from books that I have that you had sent me from your store. And I learned what the fez meant, the tassel, and everything, the ball of the tassel, what all that meant. I broke that all down to them, but they didn't seem to be really fazed by it, you know. But I was told by one of the mostee staffs that I was letting out too many secrets, you know, and secrets. I thought we were supposed to be uplifting fallen humanity. And, you know, I thought we were supposed to be uplifting them. How are you going to uplift them if you're going to keep them dumbed down like that? You can't.
Exactly.
Later on, I found out, this must be their mission, to keep them dumbed down.
Right. And Prophet Noble Dralee already told them that the secrets was already kept from the outside world, from the Moors. You know what I'm saying? Matter of fact, this is what it says. We go to the Holy Quran, Circle 7. We go to know thyself and thy father, Allah. The lessons of this pamphlet are not for sale, but for the sake of humanity, and I, the prophet and the servant, is worthy of his hire and can receive this pamphlet at expense. The reason these lessons have not been known is because the Muslims of India, Egypt, and Palestine had these secrets and kept them back from the outside world. And when the time appointed by law, they loosened the keys and freed these secrets. And for the first time in ages, has these secrets been delivered in the hands of the Muslims of America. So, to be as revealers of light, either you're going to be a revealer of light or a concealer of light.
Right.
Based on what it says in the Holy Quran, chapter 7, about the revealer, that was supposed to be our job. Matter of fact, let's go to it right quick. Let's go to it.
Right.
It says, let's see what our job is, because obviously many must have forget. It says here, we call these sons revealers of light, but they must have light before they can reveal the light. And you must teach your sons and set their souls on fire with love and holy zeal and make them conscious of their mission to the sons of man. Teach them that Allah and man are one, but that through cardinal thoughts and words and deeds, man tore himself away from Allah and debased himself. Teach them the holy breath, which makes them one again, restoring harmony and peace. You know what I'm saying? So as we realize the light, we're supposed to teach what sets the souls on fire with love and holy zeal and make them conscious of their mission to the sons of men. That's
exactly.
Our job as we realize the light.
And that's what I tried to reveal. That's what I tried to reveal. I have donated a lot of books from Ma'ata Ashby, the volumes of books to the temples. Found out that they were confiscated.
Right.
You know, so that what does that tell me? It only tells me one thing. You don't want me to reveal a light, not only to the people in the neighborhood and the community and the Moorish community, but you don't want me even to reveal a light to the people in the temple. So that you know, that showed me that I wasn't appreciated, or what I was doing for the temple was not appreciated. And I wasn't ready for them, they wasn't ready for me.
Exactly. So, because you was a new Moor who came in with your eyes wide open.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
That was more Prophet Nobodrali Shay. You know, so that's what's really going on. And for those who have clear understanding of that, overstanding, understanding of that, then you would teach the information properly. You would not try to conceal the information and keep it from your people, knowing that we're spoiling humanity. Now, I'm talking about your people, I'm talking about Asiatics.
Yes.
It's the majority of the world. 7 billion, and you're talking about at least 6.5 billion us.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Now,
yes,
let's go into this. People say, well, we don't do paperwork because it's paper terrorism. Paper terrorism.
No such thing. No.
If that's the case, then you should be able to get the IRS damn terrorizing your ass, or any damn corporation for terrorizing your ass.
In that case, yes. You get the IRS big time.
But it says this: if you have relied on prior decisions of the Supreme Court, you have the perfect defense for willfulness. United States versus Bishop 412, United States 346. Because Supreme Court cases and decisions are based on stare decisis, which is upon all courts, including municipality, tribunal, inferior courts, Article 1, 2, Article, even Article 3 courts, one must take into serious consideration that most of the paperwork received from these tribunals are voided and are prima facie evidence of paper terrorism. They are paper terrorizing you. Now they have flipped it and said, oh, you paper terrorizing them.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now you go to the Inter-American Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People. This is what it says. Self-identification as indigenous or tribal shall be regarded as a fundamental criteria for determining to which the provision of this declaration applies. This self-identification at an international level is also at the national level. However, at the national level, it's called self-identifying or self-identification. It says in the is according to federal rules of evidence, right, as well as also the state of evidence. You have the federal, which is rule 902. It says this: is evidence that is self-authentificated. It says a seal purported to be that of the United States or any state, district, commonwealth, territory.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, you know, we go to the courthouse, the clerk put a seal from the county and the state on your documentation. All right. It says also it bears the signature of an officer or employee of an entity, which is the clerk itself. The clerk is the officer of the court.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is always for self-identifying and self-authenticating who you are, your information, your indigenousship. It says a document purported to be signed or attested by a person who is authorized by foreign country laws to do so. Hence, Washington is foreign to the United States. And it also has our seal on there, and actually there's what is called foreign public documents. And this is all part of the identification process. This is all part of rules of evidence.
Yeah.
It says certified copies of public records. A copy of a official record or a copy of a document that was recorded or filed in a public office as authorized by law.
Yeah.
It says newspapers and print articles. Printed material purported to be a newspaper or print article. It says a knowledge document. It says documents occupied by a certificate of acknowledgement that is lawfully executed by a notary public or another officer who is authorized to take acknowledgement. So a notary signs your documentation. They authorize, they see that you are as your signature claims to be, right?
Yeah.
They verify your signature. They verify that this is you.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, those are the residents. Now, if I have nothing on the public, except for you saying that you are more, what's your proof? You know what, Brother L, you know, this is why 10 years ago, we started seeing brothers start getting psychic evaluations because they ain't have no paperwork. They just going up in the court system talking about they morals.
What gets me is
no
that a lot of, what gets me is a lot of morals that ask us get their names corrected and still use. Maybe there's situation. Maybe don't allow them to use their correct national name. I don't know what situation, kind of situation they're in, but they still use their straw man names. Personally, I'm thinking Withering Hell, 24/7. That's me.
Exactly.
I take it or leave it. You know, I don't know about anyone else. You know, but. A lot of more say that, well, we still use our straw man name, but while you're still using your straw man name, they still are dipping and dabbing into your trust, your Social Security and all everything else, and your trust fund from your birth certificate. They still doing that. And you still giving everything you got to the descendants of these European slave families that own your foreparents at one time. You know, so I don't know.
Exactly, that is slavery.
You know, so I said, they asked me, you put your correct name on everything. I said, yeah, why not? You think I'm gonna do all this work, going through all dealing with getting my processing papers all notarized, going to the county records and deeds, getting them filed for the public record, going to the Circuit County Courts to get them processed through there, and you think I'm going to still use my straw man name? Hell no. Hell to the no.
Yeah.
as Tyler Perry would say.
Exactly.
Hell to. I mean, you know, to me, it defeats the purpose, you know.
Right.
What is the sense of you having a corrected name or getting nationalized in your birthright if you're too scared to use it?
Right.
What is the point? Therefore, okay,
there is none.
There is no get that fez and that button, that pen, whatever. Your turban, whatever, and name, whatever, back to the prophet. And go on back to the state of mind the prophet found you at. You know. The hell with it. Is that the position you're going to take? You know. But you got to, if you're going to come out here, you're going to be whoever, Ali, whatever, well, stand on it. I definitely have no problem with it.
You know, so exactly.
That's my take on that.
No doubt about it, Brother L.
Yeah, I mean,
well,
you know, like they say, this is me. This is the Fahim was here in here. You know, this is all me. Take it or leave it.
Exactly.
You know, I have no problem telling me, you know, some people still call me Robert, you know, because they've been calling you Robert all these years. I said, well, I know what my name is, you know. I said, go on, keep calling me Robert. Because when I go sign papers and documents, you're going to see Fahim Lutheran L on them papers. All right.
That's right. Reserve.
All rights reserved, TDC,
exactly.
UCC.
Exactly.
1-103, UCC 1-1308. That's what you're going to see on my papers, on all of them.
Exactly. All right, we got some callers, Brother L. We're going to run in. We got area code 661. Area code 661, you're on the line.
Hello?
Peace.
Yes, peace.
Peace, brother. I was just listening in. This is Ned Shady Curse from out here in California. I was just listening in, you know, peeping out the information and all that.
Appreciate you.
I appreciate you listening in.
All right, it's some powerful stuff y'all talking about.
All right, appreciate it.
Okay.
Keep on listening to us.
Oh, yeah.
All right, thanks, bro. We're going to go to area code 843, area code 843,
you're
on the line.
Peace, sons. This is Queen Mother 9.
Peace, sister.
Greetings.
You guys are touching on so much tonight. I've been listening for about 15 minutes, I think. And I have so many questions. I want to take it slow because I know we don't have that much time.
It's all right. Get them in.
Hi, yeah. Aleem. Peace, Aleem.
Peace.
I met you.
Peace.
I met you,
you did?
In Atlanta. Absolutely. My husband brought the book immediately from you.
Yes, I remember. Okay, appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, so with that, me knowing that, and then I see you with the show and stuff. I've been subscribed to your emails and listen in from time to time, and it always brings me back right here to the source, Aleem. You feel me?
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Peace, co-host. I didn't get his name when I listened in. I love your
Brother
testimony.
Fahim.
Brother Sahim,
yeah,
I love your
Fahim.
Testimony. He's what made me press
one. Most appreciated, sister.
You made me press.
You made a press one, Brother L, to come on and speak with us.
Okay.
Indeed.
Appreciate you much, sister.
With that saying, it brings me to recall my feelings of nationality, and now I just heard you end your last, you know, note with the UCC and stuff, and I've got a chance to, you know, catch you, Aleem, on Blog Talk. Just recently you've been doing something on that note. Do I recall right, correct?
Right.
And I've seen you on the YouTube, you know, and that's just to let you know how I've been led up until now. So with that being said, you know, I want to bring my mother up in this because it goes also back to the birth certificate, right?
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, I don't know if there's a testimony because now it's going to bring me back to where Brother Aline was going through his testimony of being actually on the land and things. And I just, at times like this, I cannot but think that as like a heaven place, especially if I can meet the Grand Empress, the Great Mother, you know?
Right.
All right.
You feel what I'm saying? I'm trying to be slow with this.
Right, I understand. Gotcha.
Yeah.
You feeling your sister.
Okay. Because it's emotional, you know. Just to give you a brief, that I've been, you know, unbalanced with my mother. I have to use that word, unbalanced. I like that word because then I can just reflect as, you know, that symbol, that scale, and also, I don't know, you know, my ascendant or whatever, Libra, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Go into like all of the Gnostic. Yeah, that whole Gnostic talk and stuff. You know, but I'm just listening, and, you know, I know I've done drift off into an actuality, but back to, you know, being nationalized and everything, it's like, I think for me to, for one to be about it, you have to actually be on it, you know,
right,
and gain that experience that you're able to come in and testify to.
Right. There's no doubt about it. You definitely have to, in order to appreciate and see how it works for you by going to these courts and courthouses, or, you know, even standing in front of the judge, if you have to. And being able to get those cases dismissed, and you walk out of there, you know, with no lockup time, with the money still in your pocket, and the case is disposed of or dismissed. You know, and so, I mean, that's the way we have to be, because they know they don't have jurisdiction over those who are not U.S. citizens. And we're not U.S. citizens, so therefore they have jurisdiction in any shape, form, or fashion. Whether it's territorial, whether it's persona, or whether it's subject matter. They don't have it on neither of those three. But therefore, they're lacking substance, just like we read earlier about these corporations. It's a corporation. It lacks substance. So that means if it lacks substance, then that means that it can't do nothing to something in which that is real. That's why the whole thing about the Wizard of Oz, we broke down the last time, was based on Dorothy, you know, who thought that she was in a world of something in which that had substance, actually didn't have substance. Because everything that glitters isn't gold, you know,
exactly.
And that's what she came to find out. And that she had the ability to go home the whole time.
That's,
you know,
look at her shoes. So, and that's what I said, being actually able to set foot on solid ground, you know.
Exactly.
And that's how they look at you when you coming in there, like y'all was saying, how brothers coming in their courtroom and saying they are more of this, and, you know, ain't even been to the ground stages of, you know, inhabiting with them, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Really?
I said habitating.
Mm-hmm.
I really said habitating, or how they say it, because this is the season right now, you know, a mother. I don't know if there's any sisters on the line. My sisters, you know? Because
right,
I feel like Aaliyah right now, like one in a million.
Right. Well, hold on. Let's see if the next caller is a female. Let's see. 404, area code 404. You on the line?
Greetings to the family. I'm listening in. This is Brother,
brother.
Waters in Jacksonville, Florida.
Brother Waters.
And, I'm a little late, so I'm just going to be quiet and try to absorb as much as I can. And I'll say peace and blessings again to all of you, and may the ancestors bless you continually.
Blessings out, you know.
Peace and love, God.
Right, make sure you go back and listen and archive this show.
Absolutely. He just did a key word, family. That's what it's about, family. You have to show who your family is. You can't just say who your family is. You have to show who your family is. And it brings me back to my biological family. We're practically at war. It's like I've read this somewhere in the Bible, you know, when I used to study, I remember certain things that stood out to me about a prophecy of how mothers will be against daughters and things like that. And
right.
reading it back then, I exactly. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
That's what made me to press one as well, because you actually been out there as a family, so you able to come and show that wherever you go. You know, it's like that rising blow over you. Brother Eileen,
right.
the co-host, his name again.
Right.
Pardon me.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's rhyming. I know it's rhyming, brothers. Bear with me.
Okay, no, you are
right. Right.
You're doing good.
Brother Eileen, Brother Fahim.
Yeah. I'm just happy because I can say, you know, this is family. I like how he greeted the call, you know, because for me being a woman to actually say, where is the family? That's so hard on a coming from a, because we matriarchals, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
That's supposed to mean something. You know,
it does.
Exactly. Absolutely.
Yes.
But our mothers are asleep. They have been. You know, I'll be 37 years old this year.
Uh-huh.
And out of my mother's 4 C girls, I'm the only one, you know, here on the call line. Let's just say it like that.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? You hardly run into, you know, your callers saying, yo, I got my brothers right here, or I got my sisters right here. We listening to you. That's why I've been feeling like Aaliyah. You know what I'm saying? Like her songs. It just hit me when just by being on the phone with y'all, and I'm getting the chance to speak. You know, it's humbleness,
right.
like her presence. To get me also to press one. You know, it's deep.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate tonight. You know, I really do.
Appreciate you,
appreciate
Goddess.
Yeah, I'm just listening in. But all those questions that I professed earlier, you know, means a lot to me because I am going through some legal issues, custody battles, and this is between me and my mom, you know.
Oh.
Right.
And I know this is something that's real hard and touchy and stuff to really feel with, but, you know, it just fit in with the call, you know. And
right.
I had to open up like that, you know, because this is ongoing, you know. I'm just glad I'm 6 hours away, and then it's like it's a sad thing I'm 6 hours away. But I'm like, where do I have to travel to step on that land? Because I don't want to be like those ones that you're speaking of, going into the courtroom, saying this, saying that, you know, rehearsing lines and things like that. It's been an honor to come across, to come into, or this, you know, information, you know. This is like how the Christians said they done found Jesus. This is me, especially how them, you know, just the rabbit hole. I want to talk slow to you guys.
Okay.
Right.
You're doing okay, sister?
Because I can get so hyped up. You know. But you feel
if I
me?
I got you. I feel
just, you. Yeah. Yeah.
And
I feel like an ancient soul.
And something that can help you out with the custody suit with your mom is looking more into the Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People. It states in there that no state or outside entity has the right in order to take any children or anyone from out of the home of Indigenous people. You know,
yeah, but
so
it goes back to my mother being that matriarchal. They're able at you know, this is like now I see. I once was blind, but now I can see. So by me and her going in there, they're able to play both sides, you know, of the whole thing, you know. She being a mother, that's matriarchal. They know the science of it. You know what I'm saying? So they get me to prove all this motherly characteristics again, you know. But I doubt all this even on record because how they've been just sending me, trying to exhaust me and everything. But they know for one sure fact they got my mother on their side, and that's the hurt and feeling when you actually know your mother playing with the game.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
That's the whole nature of this call.
Just try not to get too emotional with it, you know. Because once you get too emotional, you lose.
Exactly.
Yes, you know.
I had to see that and you know, actually recognize that to where I'm able to keep my moves down. I'm ready to go and go and keep going until I get it right. It's practice makes perfect.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because it really done got boiled down to, even though it's my mother, but it's also the system too, now that I know the system. You know, I don't want to make it seem like, oh, I got something up against the system and exposure and stuff like that, you know. But I want to make sure I be able to come always on point. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
And that goes back to the land. That goes back to the land. Because when it's all about who can get their back up against the corner, who's back going to be up against the corner, right?
Well, you already know it's a de facto system. So
exactly.
You're right, you know. You know.
Well, I already know that, exactly.
Right.
But trying to explain this to a mother that gave birth to a child that she's up against, and she's on the no-hold bars, and then she's a Leo, I know she's my matriarch of the whole family. You know, she's the big mom,
right.
Cook. I would do anything if she wanted it on record, or let's say public and private. She go on a public way. You feel me?
Oh, yeah. I feel like what you're talking about.
That's what makes it hard. Because our people don't know how to do nothing on the private. We always telling everything. We always letting our left hand or our right hand know what the left hand doing, but yet using the same saying to others, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? I like how I had to bring that,
yes.
Letting your right hand know what the right hand doing. You know, so y'all can correct me if you want to do it the other hand around.
Right.
I'm a mother of 9. I feel really old. That means my children are older than me, right?
In what way?
Do the science. Do the knowledge, man.
Okay. Okay.
We still on that.
Return of the ancient one. Right. Return of the ancient one.
Right.
Old soul.
Well,
exactly.
Yeah. You have a lot of them too, young brothers and sisters with old souls. You know.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to be a some of us older brothers and sisters with young spirits and souls. You know, so that'll go hand in hand.
Yeah, guys, if you want to build on further on those legal matters, you can give us a call at 910-364-9099. That's 910-364-9099. Give us a call. You can definitely talk to my wife about it. She can definitely help you out with that situation.
She's beautiful.
Right. Brother L, you got any closing remarks before we go?
Yes. Pretty, as I said, I know we did a lot of good tonight. by the sister's response and the other brother's response. So we're going to keep on doing it. Keep on doing it again Wednesday night and Friday night.
Right.
So I said, that's about all I got to say about that on that end.
All right. So you know me.
Peace and love. Peace and love to you, sister.
Oh, always in love with you guys. Always in love with you guys, you know. Always right on time. Thank you for helping me press one.
Yeah, appreciate you, goddess.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, we definitely appreciate you coming on, give forth your testimony, and definitely we're going to try to help you as much as possible with that. So make sure you give us a call. And like I said, my wife can definitely help you, you know, with strategy, because we've been in court so many times. You know, we can actually lay out a game plan. First World Order Radio, finally. We are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value or natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance.
Order.
System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value or natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.